cops count. I've been saying that for the last 5-6 years. We can't have a safe city if we don't take care of the cops. And I'm going to take care of the cops.
And to start, what would be your first thing?
Well, I've already said we're going to treat you like adults. You know, they were saying about, you know, this uniform of the day business. The officer said, it's a little chilly tonight. Can I put a long sleeve shirt on? Of course you can. You're adults. I'm not going to tell you how to dress. We have a consistent uniform. How about that hat? You want to wear the hat? We really don't like to wear the hat. We don't want to be told when to wear the hat. But if it's raining out, we want to cover our head, we'll wear the hat. So guess what? You're an adult. You want to wear it? Wear it. If you don't, you don't have to. It's just that simple. Now, you might think, what's the big deal? The big deal is I value those police officers. I value. They count. I'm going to listen to them. I want to know who they view as leaders. Yes, sir.
I apologize for interrupting.
That's okay.
Are you inferring then that others previously have not viewed them?
I am not inferring anything about others. I'm just saying my style is different. You know, sometimes when you come up in an organization and you're part of a culture, it's like if you ever visited someone and you go into their home and they got a crack in the ceiling and you wonder, how come they haven't fixed that crack? Okay? And you say to your friend, you might need to fix it. And they say, wow, I got a crack. Well, there's a crack in the ceiling here and I'm going to patch that crack up. So this is not an indictment or a criticism of anybody that came before me. I'm just saying I have a different style. I see things through a different set of lenses. They count. I want them to know that. And they want to know if I'm coming back.
What about the message to the citizen, the people who live in the city? What would you say to them tonight?
Well, we got a committed police department. You got one of the best police departments in America. They need leadership. They're going to get the kind of leadership because that translates into superior service. They recognize and understand that they have to serve this community. I haven't heard from the citizens, but the police officers, said they think it's a bad idea, this virtual precinct. This is not Culver City, California, where we can shut the doors up. This is the city of Detroit. I want to make sure that when a community member needs to come into a police station, that the doors are open. This is not Santa Monica or Santa Barbara. This is Detroit.
So you're going to open them up? We're not going to have the 4 o'clock shut?
Yeah, I can't do that. I got to look at the staffing. But we got to have stations that can be accessed by the community. It doesn't work in the city of Detroit.
Equally key to what you're trying to do is equipment. How do you find funding and
I'm working on that. I've been here, how many hours I've been here? I've been here every bit and I got consultants working on that. Let me just say this. Motor City, the automobile capital, and we got dilapidated police cruisers, cars with paint peeling off the hood. I had a sergeant officer in the field the other day that, you know, the right front brake was out. Why is a police officer driving in a vehicle that way? That's not safe. They're out here to protect and serve this community, and we put them in an unsafe vehicle. I will hold, and I'm going to say it loud and clear, I will hold the command staff accountable from the rank of lieutenant above to support the men and women who do this job. I have a high expectation that you know that when these officers are in a dangerous situation like an unsafe vehicle, why are we letting them go out in the field?
So how do you go about boosting morale in a situation like that and also in a situation where, given the, you know, what the city
I think
is going through?
What I would ask that, start talking to the officers. Call Cincinnati and in less than a year, what happened to the morale there? It was the small things first. They recognize that there's a fiscal emergency in the city of Detroit. Except for one person, I didn't hear a lot of talk about money. What I did hear, we want to be able to do our jobs and want to be able to do it safely, want to do it better. We want to serve this community. That's what I've been hearing.
Do you have a message for the bad guys, the criminals?
I'm going to tell you, let me just say this. It's over. It is absolutely over. We had, in this very precinct where I started, we had a group of young people committing violent crimes. They're in jail tonight. And the message to the rest of them that want to engage, a 71-year-old man was carjacked and beaten. That is not acceptable anywhere. I'm not accepting it. And the message is, you will go to jail. We'll do it with effort. We'll do it in a very transparent, legal, and ethical way. But those days are over. I'm tired. I've been here less than a week, and to read the stories. How can you live that way? The officers know. We need to support the good community people that live here. My parents live in this city. I'm invested in Detroit. I care about this city, and we're no longer going to accept this as the norm. What, over the weekend, 13 shootings, and nobody gets excited? There should be an outcry. People should be angry. Where's the anger? Have we gotten to a place where this is okay? There are a lot of good people out in this city doing great things. I've met some of them who are part of the solution, not the problem.
What about those people questioning your salary?
I say to them, Detroit's one of the most violent cities in America. When I retired from the LAPD, I retired, and I only commanded one station, one of 22, I made $175,000. Nobody questions the salaries of CEOs of some of the major corporations in America who make well over $1 million in all the stock options. We're talking about making this city safer. We're talking about we make it a safer city. People will want to live here. People will want to invest in the city. So the salary is a non-issue as I see it.
What do you mean when you said you were going to use citizens to help fight?
Oh, we can't do it alone. I mean, I boast about the community in Cincinnati. I will tell you, I looked at the safest neighborhoods in Cincinnati, and those safest neighborhoods had a very robust citizens on patrol. We no longer can you sit back and complain. You have got to be part of the solution. And part of the solution means rolling your sleeves up. I'm gonna call out like I did in Cincinnati to the clergy leadership in this city. There's plenty of churches here. And I need help from the clergy. I need help from the neighborhood stakeholders. The businesses have already pledged their support for making this a safe city.
How soon do you think you can really start turning things around?
I've already started. Start talking to some of these police officers. They see the light at the end of the tunnel. Now, I know you good people are not going to give me a honeymoon. I realize that. I know that anything that goes on tonight, I'll be held accountable for, okay? But can I have just a little bit of time? You know, maybe a half a day, okay? And if you don't trust what I say, I just ask you to do one thing. Look at my track record. I am passionate about the work that I do. That's the message that I have to the people that live in the city of Detroit.
Appreciating it's day one, what do you do moving forward with perhaps Mr. Brown and Mr. Orr to get your arms around what financially you think the department needs and how to get it done?
Well, I've been having conversations with Mr. Orr. Mr. Orr is passionate about public safety. He's passionate about making this department work. He recognizes that there's some structural issues that are not working. In fact, you may not know it, but we've had three teams of consultants working with the Detroit Police Department over the last weeks, even before my arrival. I have been working with that consultant team, met with a team in New York. I'm in conversation with one of the lead consultants almost on a daily basis. We are serious about this business.
Can you characterize, do you guys have, obviously you've met, but I mean, do you have a rough plan that in a few weeks you'll get together after you get your arms around things, or have you got a message to you, or perhaps financially what you can expect to work with?
I'm not going to go into those details. You will find that I'm very transparent, but you want me to give you something after just a few short hours that I've been here, and I'm not going to do that. But what I will commit to you, as we move forward, you will know. One of the things I'm committed to is ongoing and regular media availability sessions at least once a month. You will know about the crime in this city in a very accurate way. I got to get my arms around the data. I want to make sure the data you get is not three different sets of numbers, but one, and that data will be accurate and it will be timely. And we will launch a CompStat process here in the city of Detroit, much like what you know about in the city of New York, Los Angeles. And you may know that one of the consultants that I'm working very closely with is former chief of police in New York, Boston, and Los Angeles, Chief Bill Bratton. We've been in conversation about the work here in Detroit. And so Detroit has a good fortune of benefiting from his successes. And having come under his tutelage, we're going to turn this around.
Are Are you going to seek more officers on the ground, or can you give us some conception?
Can I wait till I get an idea of where we are? I don't know. What I can say preliminarily, that we have officers working in non-field positions that are full duty, that should be in the field. That I know. So what I need to do first is understand and make an assessment on our current staffing and what they're doing. And then as we move forward, I might say, it's always easy for me to say, well, could I use 1,000 more officers? Well, Chief, what are you going to do with that?
Do you have an initial opinion about the 12-hour shifts? Is that something that you think can keep going?
What I don't like about 12 hours, so I'm told, the officers were forced into it. Again, that's contrary to how I lead. I've talked to the officers and across the board. I mean, there are some that like it, but there are more that don't like it. And this is an opportunity to revisit a work schedule that will benefit the officers and continue to serve our community. It's got to be a win-win here, and I'm poised to do that. And we're going to move very quickly. That's one of the things I'm going to move very quickly on, is take a critical look at our work schedule and make some changes. Because I can't understand why the cop on the beat, the one that we rely on every single day, is forced to work 12 hours when we have officers in preferred assignments, plainclothes assignments, that are working 8 hours. What's wrong with that picture? We're all going to get into this together. If the decision is we work 10 and 12s, then that's going to be how the department functions.
Response time, I know, too, that citizens really want to see that.
Oh, absolutely. You know what? Let me tell you, this response time preliminary, I can tell you, you know, when you hear the stories about 45, 50 minutes to emergency calls for service, I'm going to tell you preliminarily, that is not correct. What is correct is that there's been no prioritization of calls. You know, some calls are just not emergencies. If there was a burglary, God forbid, we understand what impact that has on a community member when they come home and find their house burglarized. But if the suspect's gone, it's not a crime in progress. What concerns me is if we have a shooting in progress, victims down, do you think it's going to take 40 to 50 minutes for a police officer to get there? No. Here's what I know, and I've talked to these officers. They're going to get there as fast as they can, and I know 3, 5, 7 minutes. So part of what we need to do is educate the community on call prioritization, because an emergency call for service should be gauged on a true emergency, and that's the response time. The LAPD does it like no one else. In a city of 4 million with 10,000 cops, our response time ranges between 5 and 7 minutes to emergencies. In Cincinnati, the response time was 3 to 4 minutes to emergencies, bona fide emergencies. But if you ask the LAPD about a non-priority call, using that example of a burglary, they're not going to get there in 7 minutes, not when you got gang members having shootouts. So we have to educate the community and say, this is not an emergency.
Why did you want this job?
Because I'm passionate about it. This is my calling. You know, I started, as you might know, as a police officer here. I didn't want to leave the city of Detroit. I was kind of forced. I was laid off. Staffing reduction. And so I had to make a choice, Toledo, Ohio, or Los Angeles. Of course, I was more attracted to palm trees and sandy beaches. And so I spent 28 years there. But the good news is it gave me a different view of policing. And so certainly the ability to come home and serve this community, because I'm still very much a part of this community. I still have strong ties here. My family still lives here. And I've never lost my love for the city of Detroit. So coming home, it's an honor.
Chief, who hired you? What are your concerns about the mayoral election?
I'm not concerned. Concerned about a mayoral election. I'm concerned about serving this community and reducing crime. It's no secret that the emergency manager is in place. And so I'm not concerned about those things. I have a contract. My mission is to reduce crime in this city, raise the morale, bring back the credibility of this great organization. And so I don't worry about mayoral races.
Thank you. Did I mishear you, or did you say something about
it? Oh, I want to know about vests.
The vest, you want them some, wearing their vests, did you say
no,
something?
No, I heard that some of them expired. You know, they have a lifespan on the vests. And so I'm told, and I'm going to look into this.
You're pro them wearing
masks. I'm pro of keeping officers safe.
Right, okay.
I'm pro of making sure they have the tools and equipment
right.
to be safe, whether it's vehicles at work,
right.
wearing protective body armor that could save their life. I'm concerned.
Did I mishear you, though, or did you say something?
No, I was talking about vests. No, you're right. Yeah. Absolutely.
So you'd like them to
yeah.
right. wear them when they're out on duty.
Now, you might detect I'm a little bit passionate. I'm not angry at anybody. I just like, I mean, I really love what I do.
Why I started number 10 again?
I started here.
That's it.
I started here.
Okay.
And as I look at the wall over there, I was emotional for a moment because I didn't realize that an individual who broke me in on a job, Everett, was my partner here at number 10. We worked a scout car together, and I was unaware that he had lost his life in the line of duty. So this would be the second person. My best friend was the first LAPD SWAT officer killed in the line of duty 5 years ago. So when I tell you that I'm about the business of keeping these officers safe and providing them whatever support they need to do that, that will happen. That must happen.
Can you give one more thought, please, in regard to what Cheryl asked you earlier? You made the comment about 13 shootings a month again. People shouldn't be outraged. One might contend people are numb to it because it's been going on for so long. That kind of corresponding with your need and call for more community support. Address the fact of what the city has been through and you know, why people still need to play a critical role in what people don't know.
We cannot accept this as the norm. We can't accept Detroit being characterized as one of the more violent cities in America. That is not acceptable. This is a great city. You know, what a lot of people don't know about the city of Detroit, you know, living in Los Angeles for 28 years, there certainly was a significant population or migrants from the city of Detroit. And everybody I met during that time had a great deal of pride in the city. There's still a great deal of pride here. People love this city. I've had a conversation with the federal monitor, certainly talking to Kevin Orr, who certainly went to school here in the state of Michigan. People love the city of Detroit. They believe in the city of Detroit. And so that's half, I mean, really, that just tells me we can make this happen. I cannot do it alone. I'm not going to even sit here and try to tell you I can do it alone. But we can do it, and we will do it.